Hello, ladies and gentlemen, participants of this conference. I hope you enjoyed it so far. My presentation deals with monitoring of forestry phenology and how monitoring can be an early warning system on climate change impacts in forest ecosystems. So let's discuss a little bit about the etymology of the word, of the term. Phenology means the study of appearance, and the term is derived from the Greek words pheno, which means to show, to bring to light, to make, to appear, and the word logos, which means study, discourse, reasoning. The term was coined for the first time from Charles Morin in 1853. So what is phenology? The study of timing and quantity of annually recurring plant growth and reproductive phenomena, as well as the drivers of these events are associated with exogenous and endogenous forces. Phenology is one of the oldest branches of environmental sciences, dating back for thousands of years. So plant phenology is a horizontal science that provides a unified measure of the timing and quantity of plant growth and reproductive phenomena at different vegetation and spatial scales. So let's have a small overview about the history of phenology. Actually, phenology started to be monitoring very, very early, even before agricultural period. And the first documents appear from 1000 to 600 before Christ in the book of poetry that was kept by the ancient Chinese. Afterwards, we had many records of phenology from different sources. Till 1730, when we reached the time of modern phenology, when Marsham kept in his UK farm, and actually this was done for almost 200 years, because it was continued from his family. So his records are used even today to extract results when comparing those data with climate and compare it also with the climate of today. Afterwards, in the first half of the 19th century, Thoreau also kept very detailed records for several species, and he really had a very good archive about phenological data on a great number of species. In 1000, then Andrew Delmar Hopkins developed and published the Hopkins biclimatic law, which really deals with the change of phenology when we move 1 degree north and 3 degrees west, and or if we move 120 meters above. And he stated that in this way, actually the phenology advances by 3 days. This law is a topic for research even today, so several studies are testing this biclimatic law up to date. So ever since, many phenological observation networks have been established, and of course, even today, we have many networks even from ordinary people who really monitor phenology and report their observations. Of course, those are not very well-established data because they're questionable for their accuracy sometimes. But still, there are professional network networks, professional networks for phenology, like the European Phenology Network or the Phenology Network in the USA. And a milestone for phenology actually was the remote sensing advantages that were provided quite recently. So we moved in this way to the global climate change phenology times. So first we started with remote sensing via Landsat, and then we have also remote sensing via MODIS, and currently we have also the unmanned aerial vehicle vehicles that they can take pictures and information about phenology, and so we can have information from various scales. So we can have on the ground data from individual observations, so from human observations, as well as from flux towers and SIF spectra data. We can also have data from phenocams. We can also have close to the surface, near surface data from unmanned aerial vehicles. And also from satellite data that really give information about how phenology evolves across the globe. Of course, all those data need to be validated, and the data should be scaled up from the ground-based data and near-surface observation by following multiple scale method observations and spatial-temporal data fusion. So the central purpose of phenology, according to Wu 2012, is to discover rhythmicity and spatial patterns within the timing and quantity of plant phenological phenomena, as well as their physical, chemical, and biological mechanisms. So the tasks of phenology are observing and recording the timing and quantity of plant phenological phenomena, usually with digital cameras, satellite remote sensing, etc., today at least, examining the correct visual records and the satellite image data, and revealing spatiotemporal traits of timing and quantity of plant phenological phenomena. And also another task is to connect the timing of phenological phenomena with climate change and with the change of climate. So phenology is affected by climate, but affects climate as well, because phenology is determined by the weather and the climate, of course. And at the same time, phenology is determining the development of foliage in the forest ecosystems, or generally in the plant ecosystems, and also controls the physiological activity of the canopy. So as it controls the development and senescence of foliage, it also affects the litter fall, the carbon and the nutrient cycle, the below canopy abiotic environment, and also the surface roughness and the surface albedo. In this way, it affects the atmospheric structure and composition. By interacting with physiological activity of the canopy, it actually affects the photosynthesis and the CO2 fluxes, the evapotranspiration and the fluxes of water, and then the energy fluxes and the volatile organic compound emissions. So through this way, phenology also affects again the atmospheric structure and composition, which in turn also affects the weather and the climate, which affects again phenology. So this is a cycle, a vicious circle actually, where when climate affects phenology and phenology affects climate. So during our era, we have to deal with the overarching threat of climate change. So the projections are speaking about increase of temperature about 6 degrees, at least in the northern areas of Europe. And actually, they speak also for the decrease of precipitation by 30 to 40% in the southern Europe, and mainly the Mediterranean area, and an increase of rainfalls in the northern part of Europe. But this still has to be verified, as we have several cases this is not confirmed. Those are models. So the phenology is the nature's calendar. Climate change can be readily detected by changes in the phenology. For instance, we know exactly which season and almost which time of the year, which month of the year the trees are bud breaking, are flushing, when they produce their flowers, and when the leaves we have the leaf senescence. So if those phenomena are moving in the season, then we see that something is going on, and it's very much related to climate change. So the patterns of tree responses are neither uniform nor universal, and they may vary among and within the species. So the trees are ideal organisms to study the climate effects in phenology, as they are sessile, so they cannot move from where they grow, and thus they have to endure and adjust to all weather conditions occurring in the site where they grow. So they have a characteristic which is called plasticity, which means that they can just shape their reaction according to the environmental changes. Of course, this happens up to a specific limit. Species also may respond differently via altering their phenology to individual environmental variables, but also in their combinations. For instance, they can respond to temperature increase, or separately, or to drought separately, but they can also respond to xerothermal conditions when those two factors coexist. Climate change-induced phenological timing mismatches may also change the dynamics of ecosystems, and this might be of extreme interest, especially in the case of insect-pollinated species, when the phenology of the insects does not match the phenology of the trees they pollinate. The phenological traits, as the timing of flowering and fructification, can be of major ecological and economic importance, because asynchrony in flowering can result in lack of fruits, in lack of seeds, and thus of regeneration in the natural ecosystems. So knowledge of the mechanisms underlying phenological responses is needed to further understand the causes of the observed phenological changes or their lack. So we need to understand the genetic and the physiological mechanisms that plants use for the timing of seasonal responses, and how we can have the prediction of phenological responses and assessments of the adaptive capacity to non-analog climates that we are expecting via climate change. For all the above reasons, phenology has become of major interest within the fields of conservation, ecology, evolution, and agronomy, among others. So let's see which are the drivers and mechanisms behind the phenological changes. The timing of phenology events is determined by various biological and environmental factors, of course, and the extent of their influence on phenology depends on the developmental stages of the phenological events, and also the plant-specific differences in life history traits. So the factors that affect phenology are temperature. This is a main factor affecting all phenological traits. So it affects traits in the spring, in the autumn, and all kinds of traits. So temperature is very much important because it's related to the physiological activity of the trees, and thus affects all their function. Another factor which affects phenology is photoperiod. There are many species that besides temperature, they get signals for photoperiod in order to initiate their cessation and/or their bud break during the springtime. It has been noted, of course, that photoperiod is much more important during the autumn period, and especially for the leaf senescence, because usually this event is happening in the same time across years, no matter what. Another factor is water and nutrient availability. Precipitation is a very important factor, as it is related to the growing degree days, as well as with the cooling degree days. And also it is linked with the nutrient availability and also the soil water content. Another factor is the interaction among phenological phases. Usually delay in leaf cessation or cessation of growth during autumn results or is related with delayed flushing in spring. And of course, last but not least, and of course very significant factor is the genetics. So let's discuss a little bit about bud break, and we see three different species. Fagus, which is controlled by chilling, photoperiod, and temperature in order to proceed to initiate flushing. Another species, forestry species, is Carpinus, which is controlled, its flushing is controlled by chilling and temperature alone. And another species, Syringa, whose flushing is controlled only by temperature. This means that different species have different toolboxes to get the signals on when to initiate bud break. So, phenology shift scenarios give us an indication of what happens regarding growth cessation, bud set, senescence, dormancy, and bud break. So, in the first warming scenario we examine here is the current climate. So we have the growth cessation during autumn, which is followed by bud set, and then by senescence, leaf senescence, and then by dormancy. And of course, then we have bud break during the springtime. So this is the current situation. So if we have warming, we have increased temperature, this scenario says that the growth cessation will be delayed, actually, and the period among the growth recession and the budget will be reduced, and also the senescence will be delayed together with the dormancy. All this situation will result, as I said before, to the delay of the bud break. But the increase of temperature actually moves bud break earlier. So normally bud break should be here, but because of the high temperature, the bud break is expected to move earlier in the season. According to the warming scenario number two, actually the increase of temperature may accelerate the growth cessation, which will be closely followed by bud set, and then there will be a longer period, so the senescence will move much further, while the dormancy will come earlier. So all of this situation again is expected to result to the delay of bud break, but again the increase of temperature, the general decrease of temperature, is expected to result also to moving the flushing earlier in the season. But not only temperature, other environmental factors may have the opposite effect, as for instance precipitation. Xerothermic conditions may lead to delay of phenological events again due to stresses imposed to plants. So here we are going to see a genetic network mediating the control of bud break in hybrid aspen. We see that low temperature, actually all this network is controlled by mudbox genes and actually the short vegetative phase transcriptor factors. So we see here the transcriptor factor SLV and its downstream product TCP18, which are now regulated by low temperature. So SLV, transcription factor, actually mediates bud break by acting antagonistically against gibberellic acid, which actually has a positive effect on bud break, and abscisic acid, which has a negative effect on bud break. So if we have extended low temperatures, then this fact will promote the bud break by which way? By down-regulating the SLV expression and thereby relieving the repressive effect of ABA and promoting the GA, which actually allows the bud break for the plants. So this is a hypothesis of how low temperature through chilling may actually help plants flush. So here we have the gene expression from early development to senescence of hybrid aspen leaves. We can see actually the early development of the leaves here till the late developmental phases. And here we have the expression of the genes across all those phases. So it's IA, IB, IC, ID, and EE. And we can see the phases in order in this part of the graph. So we can see that there are several genes that are upregulated. So all those genes are acting during this period of early development, and those as well. While those genes that are acting in this early period are downregulated later on when the leaves are actually developing and are reaching their final the final stage. What we can see in this part over here is that in the beginning, in the early development, the genes that are expressed more heavily, more intensively, are those of primary metabolism, of ribosome biogenesis, of protein biosynthesis, of cell organization, of biogenesis, and of course photosynthesis. And we can see that in the different phases, as the leaves are growing, different genes are expressed more intensively, like the cell wall biosynthesis and the amino acid and derivative metabolisms, or the response to abiotic stimulus. So in this way, it is very clear actually that the leaf development is very much, the phenology of leaf development is very much controlled by the activity and the expression of genes. Now we're moving to the next trait, a phenological trait, to flowering. So for a tree to flower, we have to think how a tree responds actually to flowering and to growth, because actually there are two factors competing among each other, and there is a competition among them. So actually we can see the resources gathered through photosynthesis here in this pot, and here there are compartments. So as the tree accumulates resources, this budget is increasing, and actually it allocates resources to its trunk, its leaves, its branches, in order to use it later on. So we can see here that this budget is almost full, and actually if there is any excess, then this excess is used for flowering. And it is used for flowering if the plant actually satisfies the need of growth and maintenance. So when the leaves when the flowers are created, then we have the formation of fruits. Of course, the formation of fruits or seeds demands a great amount of resources. So in this case, part of the resources of the plant are depleted. So it needs the plant probably, if it is in stress, it has to delay much more time. So we can see here how the flowering is controlled by the mud box genes. And actually the class A, B, and C is the ABC system on how the flower is created. So different genes, different groups of genes are active for the creation of the sepals, the petals, and also the carpophylls and the stamens. So in this graph, we see how the photoperiod and how the circadian clock affects the flowering of Arabidopsis, for instance. So we have a factor, a transcription factor here, a CO factor, which is activated by the circadian clock. And then if the day is long enough, then this factor activates an FT transcription factor, which is produced by a specific gene. Then this factor actually goes to the apical shoot up here, to the apical meristem, and it travels through the phloem, and then it combines with the FD transcription factor, and both of them together, they interact and they activate the leaf, the genes that control actually the flowering of the plant. Of course, there are other pathways that are related to the GI biosynthesis and signaling. Also here, we can see the genetic architecture, architecture of maize and its flowering time. So we can see that many different QTLs are acting in different lines of maize, and they actually result in differences in flowering of individual lines. So QTLs, number of QTLs and their effect are related with the days where flowering is recorded. So let's see a case study which deals with monitoring of flowering phenology on 60 black pine genotypes and implication of flowering to interannual climate variation and the variation to the seed crop. So the main requirement for plants, not only in seed orchards, but also in nature, is panmixia. So it's the equal probability of all individuals to participate as parents in all crossings. For this to happen, what we do need is flowering synchronization that affects gene exchange among individuals. So we can see in this case study that we have 2 years. The one is close to the normal. The normal temperature here is the red line, the red solid line. And we can see that here we have a climate close to the normal, but here we have an increase of temperature, and especially during the winter period. At the same time, during 2007, we have a significant loss of precipitation. So what was the result of these xerothermic conditions? We monitored the male and female phenotypes, for all 60 genotypes, and actually we saw that during the normal year, the pollen of all clones was shed during the same time that the female flowers were receptive. And you can see that here there is a synchronization overlap in flowering among male and female flowers. In the xerothermic here, we have first the pollen setting, and then it's followed by the receptive phase of the female conlets. And here you can see how flowering has evolved for all the 60 individuals tested in this experiment. So what we found out is that in the xerothermic here, the onset of all phases of female flowering were delayed by several days, while the termination and the duration of the male flowering was came much more earlier. And this actually created the distance among the two phases. Here we can see that during the normal year, the initiation of flowering, both for male and female flowering, is strongly controlled by genetics, so the heritability is quite high. While during the xerothermic year, only the initiation of the male flowering is controlled by genetics quite high. Here we can see that the different genotypes have different maleness and femaleness indexes, which means that the sex is not equal on each tree, fact that affects the contribution of each individual to the seed crop. And here we can see the results for the normal year and the xerothermic year. And we can see here the 20 maternal clones actually, which were pollinated by all 60 clones and their pollen. And we can see that during the xerothermic year, which is this graph, we have a higher kinship in the seed crop, as we have increased seed produced through selfing, and also we have increased proportion of seed which resulted through the pollination of specific parents. So we have a stronger family full seed structure. Also, the same is noted for the half-seed families. So we have more half-seed families, which is very much, of course, wanted, but still the relationship among all those quasi-produced progenies is higher than that recorded during the normal year. So the conclusions are that monitoring phenology is of great importance in understanding plant responses to climate warming. Changes in plant phenology may have significant implications for forest ecosystems, their carbon cycles and feedbacks to climate, for species and population genetic variation levels, the reduction of which may pose threat to their evolutionary potential and their very existence. Thus, phenology should be an integral part of a forest monitoring scheme, as it may serve as an early warning system for the impact of climate change on tree species, populations and their gene pools, facilitating, of course, the need for fast adaptation of forest management strategies to climate change. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention.